الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد فقال جل وعلا ألم نشرح لك صدرك Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Over the past few weeks, all the talks have been regarding Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the first week, we looked at the status of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A status which is equal to none other. A status which is second to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the second week, we looked at the mercy of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How kind and how merciful our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. And last week, we looked at the character and the person of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an example, a model for every person of every profession in the world. Let us now begin to look at the major events of importance which took place in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life. Beginning today with the splitting of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's heart. Before I even begin, I must make it clear that it is possible that some of you may find the first 5 minutes of the talk difficult to understand, pending on how much Islamic knowledge you have. But bear with me as I assure you that the remaining portion of the talk is very, very easy to understand. This event, the splitting of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's chest and the cleansing of the heart, happened 4 times in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life. Living at a time in which you and I are influenced by the West, at a time in which people's iman has become weak and people find it difficult to believe in the unnatural, in the unseen, I would like to make it clear that all 4 events are proven by Sahih Hadith. Authentic Ahadith and Ahadith Mu'tabara, Ahadith which can be taken as evidence, as we shall soon see later on. This is why great masters like Allama Qastalani in his book Mawahib al-Ladunniya and Allama Zurqani in the commentary of Mawahib al-Ladunniya write, كَثُمَّ إِنَّ جَمِيعَ مَا وَرَدْ مِنْ شَقِّ الصَّدْرِ واستخراج الكلب وغير ذلك من الأمور الخارقة للأعدة مما يجب التسليم له دون التعرض لصرفه عن حقيقته لصلاحية القدرة فلا يستحيل شيء من ذلك. هكذا قال القرطبي في المفهم والتيبي والدوربشتي والحافظ في الفتح والسيوطي وغيرهم، ويؤيده الحديث الصحيح أنهم كانوا يرون أثر المخيط في صدره صلى الله عليه وسلم. Great masters like Allama Qasdalani and Allama Zurqani write that all this that has been related referring to the splitting of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's chest and taking out of the heart and cleansing of the heart and matters and events of this nature, they write, مِمَّا يَجِبُ التَّسْلِيمُ لَهُ. It is wajib, it is compulsory on every Muslim to believe in this as it has been related and take the literal meaning. Why? لِصَلَاحِيَّةِ الْقُدْرَةِ فَلَا يَسْتَحِيلُ شَيْءٌ مِّن ذَلِكَ. As nothing is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Great masters like Imam Qurtubi, Allama Tibi, Allama Turbashti, the great master Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Jalaluddin Suyuti and others have all mentioned the same. The first time, my brothers and sisters, this event took place was when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was only a child and being fostered and nursed and weaned by Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiallahu ta'ala anha, as is proven by many ahadith, like the hadith of Utbah ibn Abd, which can be found in Al-Mustadrak lil-Hakim, regarding which Imam Hakim himself and Imam Zahabi are of the opinion that this is a sahih hadith, an authentic hadith. The hadith of Abu Zar, regarding which Allama Zurqani says, كَلَا شَكَّ فِي صِحَتِهِ, that there is no doubt whatsoever that this hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sahih. As Hafiz Ziyahuddin in Al-Mukhtara, his book Al-Mukhtara, has said that this hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sahih. The third hadith is of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala an. All the narrators of this hadith are sound. The fourth hadith is of Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. The fifth is of Hazrat Shaddad ibn Aws radiyallahu ta'ala an. And the sixth hadith is of Hazrat Khalid ibn Ma'dan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So as we can see that this event, this first event which took place when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was only a child and being fostered and nursed by Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiyallahu ta'ala anha, is proven by many authentic ahadith. Let us now begin with how this event took place, how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came into the care of Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and how she became the foster mother of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I will explain the hadith as I go along, bringing in many narrations at the same time. Hazrat Halima radiyallahu ta'ala anha narrates, قدمت مكة في نسوة من بني سعد بن بكر نلتمس الرضاعة. Hazrat Halima radiyallahu ta'ala anha relates that I left for Mecca with my husband and little son whom she was nursing at the time among the women of her tribe Banu Sa'd ibn Bakr in search of children, in search of other babies to nurse. So far in this hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, three people have been mentioned. The first being Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiyallahu ta'ala anha. The second, her husband. And the third, her son. Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiyallahu ta'ala anha was the foster mother of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had great love for his foster mother. When she came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after prophethood, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on seeing his foster mother, spread his sheet for her and embraced his mother, exclaiming, Ya Umma, Ya Umma, O my mother, O my mother. Her husband was Harith. And he also embraced Islam. And her son, which is mentioned in this hadith, was the foster brother of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah. Abdullah used to say to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Oh my brother, is a prophet going to rise?" Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say to Abdullah, "By him in whose hands my life is in, oh Abdullah, I shall hold your hand on the day of resurrection, and surely I shall recognize you." When Abdullah embraced Islam, he would sit and he would cry and he would weep and he would say, "I hope that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam holds my hand on the day of resurrection and I attain salvation." Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha set for Mecca with her husband Haris and her baby son Abdullah in search of other babies, in search of children to nurse. It was customary in those days that children of rich and noble houses were sent out to the countryside to be nursed in a free, in a pure atmosphere. Women from the countryside, outside Mecca, outside the Haram, would visit Mecca twice a year, in spring and autumn, looking for children to nurse. These women would come, they would take the children back with them, they would nurse them, and once they had finished, they would return the children to their parents. The reason the well-to-do in the towns and cities gave their children in their charge was so that the young ones learned chaste Arabic and preserved the culture and the characteristics of the Arab race. In the hadith, أنا أعربكم أنا من قريش واسترضئت في بني سعد بن بكر. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself has said that he owed his pure language and eloquence to his upbringing amongst the tribe of Banu Sa'd ibn Bakr, the tribe of Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiallahu ta'ala anha. And this custom of sending the young ones to the countryside so they learn pure and chaste Arabic and preserve the characteristics of the Arab race and the Arab culture was kept long alive even after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even in the days of the Umayyads, when the seat of the government had been shifted to Dimash, to Damascus, the princes were generally brought up in the countryside in Bedouin homes. And out of all the Umayyad Khalifs, Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, for certain reasons, was the only one that could not be sent into the country, into the countryside. And thus he, out of all the Umayyad Khalifs, was the only prince who could not speak correct Arabic. So Hazrat Halima Sa'diya radiallahu ta'ala anha, because of this custom, says, قَدِمْتُ مَكَّةَ فِي نِسْوَةٍ مِّن بَنِي سَعْدِ بْنِ بَكْرٍ نَلْتَمِسُ الرَّضْعَى فِي سَنَةٍ شَهْبَاء أَلَا أَتَانٍ لِي وَمَعِي سَبِيٌّ لَنَا وَشَارِفٌ لَنَا وَاللَّهِ مَا تَبِدُّ بِقَطْرَةٍ وَمَا نَنَامُ لَيْلَنَا ذَلِكَ أَجْمَعُ مَعَ سَبِيِّنَا ذَاكَ لَا يَجِدُ فِي ثَدْيَي مَا يُغْذِي وَلَا فِي شَارِفِنَا مَا يُغْذِي. She says that I came to Mecca with some women belonging to the tribe of Banu Sa'd ibn Bakr. And this was a year of famine when they were destitute. She was riding a dusky she-donkey which had kept all the other riders back due to its weakness and it had become a nuisance to them. She had with her a very old she-camel regarding which she says, وَاللَّهِ مَا تَبِدُّ بِقَطْرَةٍ. Such was the state of this she-camel that it did not yield a drop of milk. And thus due to hunger, they could not sleep. And their child Abdullah, who she was also nursing at the time, would cry all night due to hunger. Why? لا يجد في سدي ما يغذي ولا في شارفنا ما يغذي. Nor did she have sufficient milk to give him, and nor could the she camel provide enough to satisfy him. These were the hardships Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha and her family were going through. Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha thereafter relates, فَقَدِمْنَا مَكَّةَ فَوَاللَّهِ مَا عُلِمَتْ مِنَّا إِمْرَأَةٌ إِلَّا وَقَدْ أُرِذَ عَلَيْهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَتَعْبَى إِذْ قِيلْ إِنَّهُ يَتِيمٌ مِّنَ الْأَمْرِ. She says, we reached Mecca and we began to look out for children to foster. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was offered to each and every one of us. And each and every one of us refused to take Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was offered to us. When we were told that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an orphan. Why? Inna kunna narajul ma'ruf min abi sabi. Because we hope to receive a payment from the child's father once we had finished nursing the child. And when we were told that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a yatim, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an orphan, we would say, Ma asa an tasna ummahu wahda? What will his mother and grandfather be able to do for us? They will not manage. And thus, we refuse Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But my brothers, what did the women of Banu Sa'd ibn Bakr know at the time? Little did they know that this child that they are refusing is not an ordinary child. Little did they know how special this child was. Little did they know at the time that this child is not a yatim, is not an orphan, but the creator of the heavens and the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has taken the responsibility of his upbringing, and Allah himself will reward those who take care of him. Little did they know at the time that this child held the keys to Jannah, the keys to eternal success. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was presented to each and every woman. But each and every woman from the tribe of Banu Sa'd ibn Bakr refused Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, refused to foster and take care of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fearing that his mother will not be able to manage to help them. Hazrat Halima Sa'diyah radiallahu ta'ala anha says, فَوَاللَّهِ مَا بَقِيَ مِنْ سَوَاحِبِ إِمْرَأَةٌ إِلَّا أَخَذَتْ رَضِيعًا غَيْرِ. That all the women that I had come with, they had found a child to foster for themselves besides me. And they were ready to depart. فَلَمَّا لَمْ أَجِدْ غَيْرَ. When I could not find anyone besides Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I said to my husband, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَكْرَهُ أَنْ أَرْجِعَ مِنْ بَيْنِ سَوَاحِبِ لَيْسَ مَعِي رَضِيٌّ. I said to my husband, by Allah, I do not like the idea of returning with my friends without a suckling, without a child to foster. لَأَنْطَلِكَنَّ إِلَىٰ ذَلِكَ الْيَتِيمِ فَلَأَخُذَنَّهُ. That I will definitely go to that yatim, to that orphan, and I will definitely take this child. She says, my husband said, لَا عَلَيْكَ أَنْ تَفْعَلِي أَسَلَّهُ أَنْ يَجْعَلَ لَنَا فِيهِ بَرَكَةً. That my husband said, O Halima, do as you please. Perhaps Allah will bless us on this account. She says, so I went and took him for the sole reason that I could not find anyone besides him. She says, فَذَهَبْتُ فَإِذَنْ بِهِ مُدْرَجٌ فِي سَوْبِ سُوفٍ أَبْيَضْ مِنَ اللَّبَنِ يفوح منه المسك وتحته حريرة خضراء راقد على كفاء. That I took Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The child was wrapped in wool and he was more whiter than milk, and the smell of musk was diffusing from him, and he was sleeping lying down on his back. He was so beautiful. فأشفقت أن أوقظه من نومه لحسنه وجماله. And I didn't find it appropriate to wake him up from his sleep due to his remarkable beauty. I came close to him. فوضعت يدي على صدره. And I placed my hand on his chest. And the child began to smile. And he opened his eyes to look at me. And when he looked at me, فخرج من عينيه نور حتى دخل خلال السماء وأنا أنظر. A nur came out of his eyes. A light came out of his eyes. And this light entered the heavens as I was watching. As soon as she picked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha, from Halima became Halima Sa'diya, Halima, the fortunate one. And her life completely changed. And she began to see the blessings of taking Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When she came, she had no milk to give to her own flesh and blood, to her own son Abdullah. But as soon as she took Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as soon as she picked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, her chest overflowed with milk. She relates, I gave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam my right side. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank till he was satisfied. She then gave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam her left side. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refused to drink from the left. The ulama regarding this have said, كَأَلْهَمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ أَنَّ لَهُ شَرِيكًا فَأَلْأَمَهُ الْعَدْلِ. The ulama have written that at that age when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was only a few days, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taught to be just. Knowing that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a foster brother and that child Abdullah is still yet to drink, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refused to drink from the left. She says they both drank and then they both slept. فقام صاحبي إلى شارفنا تلك فإذا أنها لحافل. She says my husband thereafter went to the old she-camel, the very same she-camel which had not a drop of milk inside its udder. She says, to our surprise, my husband found that her udders were full of milk. He milked it and he and I drank of milk until I and he were completely satisfied. وَبِتْنَا بِخَيْرِ لَيْلَةٍ. And we passed a very happy night. In the morning, my husband said to me, O Halima, Ya Halima, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَرَاكْ قَدْ أَخِسْتِ نِسْمَةٍ مُبَارَكَةٍ أَلَمْ تَرَ مَا بِتْنَا بِهِ اللَّيْلَ مِنَ الْبَرَكَةِ وَالْخَيْرِ حِينَ أَخَذْنَا. Said, O Halima, by Allah, I think that you have taken a very blessed child. And how true Harith, the foster of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father, was when he said, إِنِّي لَأَرَاكَ قَدْ أَخِذْتِ نِسْمَةً مُبَارَكَ. That you have taken a very blessed child. He and his wife and the Sahaba thereafter witnessed how blessed Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was and the blessings that came with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there are hundreds and hundreds of ahadith regarding this matter. In the hadith narrated by Imam Muslim on the authority of Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala an, Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, كَجِئْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَوْمًا فَوَجَدْتُهُ جَالِسًا مَا أَصْحَابِهِ يُحَدِّثُهُمْ وَقَدْ أَصَبَ بَطْنَهُ بِعْصَابَتِ. That one day I visited Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and found Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sitting with the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, talking to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, while Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's stomach was tied with a bandage. on saying that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's stomach was tied with a bandage. I asked the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, لِمَا أَصَبَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بَطْنَهُ. Why has Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam bandaged his stomach? They replied, مِنَ الْجُوءِ. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam has done this to relieve himself, to relieve his hunger. Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that I immediately went to Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu and informed Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's situation. Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu in turn came to my mother and asked my mother, Hal min shay'in? Is there anything to eat? My mother replied, Indi kisrun min khubzin wa tamarat. That I have some pieces of bread and dates. فَإِنْ جَاءَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَحْدَى أَشْبَعْنَا وَإِنْ جَاءَنَا مَا أَحُوْ بِأَحَدٍ قَلَّ عَنْهُ. That if Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes alone, then we can feed him. And this little food that we have will be sufficient for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, if Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brings somebody with him, then this food that we have will not be sufficient for them. Now, Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, on hearing this, Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to me, okay, go to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and stand close to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leaves the gathering and the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum disperse and return to their houses, and when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is all alone, follow Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that my father is inviting you. Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, فَفَعَلْتُ ذَلِكَ. That I did what Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu told me to do. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was all alone, I told Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that my father is inviting you. But he says, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called his companions and said to them, Ya ha'ulai ta'alu, come, Abu Talha has invited us. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took my hand and advanced with his companions. He says, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was close to the house, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam let go of my hands. I entered, وَأَنَا حَزِينٌ لِكَثْرَةِ مَنْ جَاءَ بِهِ. And I was upset because of the amount of people that had come. And I said, Ya Abata, قَدْ قُلْتُ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الَّذِي قُلْتَ لِي. O Abba, I told Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what you told me to say to him. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has called his companions and they are all coming to our house. Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu went to greet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, إِنَّمَا أَرْسَلْتُ أَنَسًا لِيَدْءُكَ وَحْدَكَ. Ya Rasulullah, I sent Anas only to invite you alone. وَلَمْ يَكُنَ عِنْدِي مَا يُشْبِعُ مَنْ أَرَى. And Ya Rasulullah, I do not have enough to feed all these people that I see. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abu Talha, wa Abu Talha, udkhul. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سَيُبَارِكْ فِي مَا عِنْدِ. O Abu Talha, do not worry, as Allah will give barakah in your food. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu to gather the little food they had. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed for barakah and then said to Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, allow 8 guests to come in and have their meal. 8 sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in came and ate till they're full. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, let another 8 come. Another 8 came and they ate to their full. Like this, 8 came and ate and they kept on coming till all 80 guests had eaten to their full. Though this very same food before Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked like as if it will only be sufficient for one person. And now, all 80 have eaten. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ate from the very same food. Hazrat Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu's family ate from the very same food. And still, the same amount of food was left over as they began with. In another hadith also taken up by Imam Muslim radiallahu ta'ala an, on the authority of Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that my mother was a mushrika, a polytheist. And I kept on inviting my mother to Islam. One day, when I was telling her about Islam and the Nabi of Islam, and I was inviting her to embrace Islam, my mother expressed rudeness towards the dignity of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I could not bear it. And I was put to so much hardship that I, Abu Huraira, weeping, went to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, Ud'u Allah an yahdiya umma Abi Huraira ila al-Islam. O Messenger of Allah, please pray for guidance for my mother. He says, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed for my mother to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O Allah, direct the mother of Abu Huraira to the right path. Hearing the prayer of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for my mother, I very happily returned to my house and found the door of my house closed. Hearing my footfall and guessing that it was I, my mother called from inside, O Abu Huraira, wait outside for a while. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, in the meanwhile, I heard the sound of water falling. My mother opened the door and after taking a bath, said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, that I testify there is no God worthy of worship, and I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. There are hundreds and hundreds of ahadiths like this, in which how blessed Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, and the blessings that came from with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is clearly evident. Just the presence of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amongst the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een was such that according to the hadith which can be found in Tirmizi, لا تمس النار مسلما رآني, the fire of hell is haram on the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. It will not touch the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een because they had seen Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with their eyes. We, the Ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have not been deprived also. We have received countless favors and blessings from Allah the Almighty just because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From an ordinary ummah, nation, like those before us, we became, as the Quran says, خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَنْتُمْ أَفْخَرُهَا وَأَكْرَمُهَا عَلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. We became the best of all ummahs just because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We became ummatan wasatan, a moderate ummah, لِتَكُونُ شُهْدَى عَلَى النَّاسِ, so that we may be a witness against the people. This is all because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we were given a very easy deen, a very easy religion to practice upon. The Quran says, مَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لَيَجْعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ حَرَجٍ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. The whole of the earth is a masjid, and if one cannot perform wudu for some reason or another, then it is permissible for us to make tayammum. We can read namaz wherever we wish. If there is no water available, Allah says that we can make tayammum. As for those nations that were before us, laws in their deen were not as easy. They could not pray wherever they wished. There were special places, fixed places, in which they had to offer their prayers. If anything impure touched their skin or clothes, it was compulsory upon them to cut the impure area. If there was something impure on their hands, then they would have to cut that skin off. If there was something impure on their trousers, then they would have to cut the area off. Yet all we have to do is wash the area, and the area will become clean and pure. One of the conditions of tawbah, of repentance, in some of the nations before us was that they had to kill themselves for their tawbah, for repentance to be accepted. As for this ummah, this condition no longer remains. Because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah gave us a very easy deen. And at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala
will give us more reward, more thawab for our deeds in comparison to the nations before us. Imam Bukhari has taken out a hadith on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا أَجُلُكُمْ فِي أَجْلِ مَنْ خَلَى مِنَ الْأُمَمْ مَا بَيْنَ صَلَاةِ الْأَصْرِ إِلَى مَغْرِبِ الشَّمْسِ. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that your period in comparison to the period of the previous nation is like the period between the Asr prayer and Maghrib prayer. The period that you will stay on the surface of this earth is like the period between Asr and Maghrib, a very short period. The least period between any two salahs is the period between Asr and Maghrib. The period between Fajr and Zuhr is a long period. The period between Zuhr and Asr is also a long period. Those nations that were before us, their period was a long one, like the period between these prayers. As for your period, it is a very short one. It is like the period between Asr and Maghrib. Thereafter, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُكُمْ وَمَثَلُ الْيُهُودِ وَالنَّسَارَى كَرَجُلٍ إِسْتَعْمَلَ أُمَّالَ. Your example in comparison to the Jews and Christians is like the example of a man who employed some laborers. And he said to these laborers, مَنْ يَعْمَلُ لِي إِلَى نِصْفِ النَّهَارِ عَلَى قِيرَاتٍ قِيرَاتٍ. Who will work for me from morning till midday? And he will receive one qirat. فَعَمَلَتِ الْيَهُودِ إِلَى نِصْفِ النَّهَارِ عَلَى قِيرَاتٍ قِيرَاتٍ. The Jews volunteered to work till midday for one qirat. And after working till midday, they received their due. Thereafter this man said, مَنْ يَعْمَلُ لِي مِنْ نِصْفِ النَّهَارِ إِلَى صَلَاةِ الْأَصْرِ عَلَى قِيرَاتٍ قِيرَاتٍ. Who will work for me from midday till Asr prayer for one qirat? This time the Christians volunteered to work till Asr for one qirat. The Christians worked and they received their due. And then this man said, مَنْ يَعْمَلُ لِي مِنْ صَلَاةِ الْأَصْرِ إِلَى مَغْرِبِ الشَّمْسِ عَلَى قِيرَاتٍ قِيرَاتٍ. That who will work for me from Asr till Maghrib, and he will receive not one but two qira. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, wa sahaba, ala fa antum alladhina ta'maluna min salati al-asr ila maghrib ash-shams. That you are the ones, the Muslims, who are working from salatul asr, from the asr prayer till sunset, till the maghrib prayer, ala lakum al-ajru marratayn, and you are the ones who will receive the reward double, will receive the reward twice. فَغَدَبَتِ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَ. The Jews and Christians became very angry and said, نَحْنُ أَكْثُرُ عَمَلًا وَأَكَلُ أَطَاعًا. That we have done more work. We worked for a longer period, and yet we have got less wages. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, هَلْ ظَلَمْتُم مِّنْ حَقِّكُمْ شَيْئًا. That have I oppressed you? Have I been unjust to you as regards to your rights? They replied, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِنَّهُ فَضْلِي أُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ شِئْ. Then this is my blessing, which I bestow on whomever I like. So because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are receiving double reward for our deeds in comparison to the nations before us. Not only this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this ummah the night of power, which is more superior than 1,000 months. The Quran says, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, wama adraka ma laylatul qadr, laylatul qadr khayru min alfi shahr. That the night of power is better than 1,000 months. If somebody from this nation was to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just in the night of qadr, and somebody from the nations before us was to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously for 1,000 months, the person worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the night of power from this ummah, his reward will outweigh the reward of the person who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously for 1,000 months in the nations before us. These are just some of the blessings that we, the Ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have received in this world because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the next world, the hadith states, فَأَكُونُ أَنَا وَأُمَّتِ أَوَّلُ مَنْ يُجِيدُ الصِّرَاطَ, that we, the Ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will be the first to cross the bridge of Sirat. نَحْنُ أَوَّلُ مَنْ يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ رَوَاهُ مُسْلِمُ, and we will be the first Ummah to enter Jannah. No Ummah will enter Jannah before us. And the number of people entering Jannah from this Ummah will be far greater than any other nation. Hazrat Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates, خَطَبَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, that one day, Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم delivered a sermon. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أَلَا لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا نَفْسُ مُسْلِمَةً, that only a believing person will enter Jannah. Allahumma hal ballagtu, oh Allah, have I conveyed the message? Allahumma ishhad, oh Allah, be witness that I have conveyed the message. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thereafter said, أَتُحِبُّونَ أَنَّكُمْ رُبُوا أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, O Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een, would you like it if you constitute one quarter of the inhabitants of Jannah? The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied in the affirmative, نَعَمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, oh yes, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thereafter asked, أَتُحِبُّونَ أَن تُكُونُوا ثُلُثَ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, would you like it if you constitute one third of the inhabitants of Jannah? Yet again the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu ajma'een replied in the affirmative. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu ajma'een, إِنِّي لَأَرْجُوا أَن تُكُونُوا شَطْرُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, إِنِّي لَأَرْجُوا أَن تُكُونُوا شَطْرُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, that I hope that you will constitute half of the inhabitants of Jannah. That out of all the people entering Jannah from all the nations, from Hazrat Adam alayhi salam's nation to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's nation, half of its inhabitants will be from my ummah, the ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet ma antum fi siwakum min al-umam illa kasharati al-sawda fi thawr al-abyad aw kasharati al-bayda fi thawr al-aswad, yet you in comparison to the other nations will be like a black hair on a white ox, or like a white hair on a black ox. These are just some of the blessings that this ummah has received because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and will receive because of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how true Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha's husband was when he said, لَكَدْ أَخِذْتِ نِسْمَةً مُبَارَكَةً, O Halima, I think that you have taken a very blessed child. Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anhu thereafter says, فَوَدَّعَتِ النِّسَاءَ بَعْضَهُنَّ وَوَضَعْتُ أَنَّ أُمَّ النَّبِيِّ ثُمَّ رَكِبْتُ أَعْتَانِي وَأَخَصْتُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. She says that the women said farewell to each other, and I said farewell to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's mother. I climbed onto the she-ass with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what do I notice? فَنَزَرْتُ إِلَى الْأَتَانِ وَقَدْ سَجِدَتْ نَحْوَ الْكَعْبَةِ ثَلَاثَ سَجِدَاتِ, I noticed that the she-ass facing Kaaba made sajda, bow down, 3 times. It was like as if this beast was thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of having received the honor of carrying the best of all creation. Then this very same beast, مَشَتْ حَتَّى سَبَقَتْ ذَوَابَ النَّاسِ الَّذِينَ كَانُوا مَعِي, this very same beast began traveling at such a pace that the other donkeys could not keep up. The women were astonished and began to remark, O Halima, أَهَذِهِ أَتَانُكَ الَّذِي كُنْتِ عَلَيْهِ وَأَنْتِ جَاعِيَةُ مَعْنَا تُخْفِدُكَ طَوْرًا وَتَرْفَعُكَ أُخْرَى, O Halima, isn't this the donkey on which you started with? The very same donkey which kept us behind and was a nuisance to us? And now it is traveling at such a pace that it is leaving us behind? Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha replied that this is the very same donkey. They said, إِنَّ لَهَا لَشَعْنَا, O Halima, something extraordinary has happened to this donkey. As the Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha says, ثم قدمنا منازل بني سعد ولا أعلم أرضا من أرض الله أجد. She says that we came to our dwellings in the Banu Sa'd country, in the Banu Sa'd area, and I do not know an area more barren than this. When we had Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with us, my flock used to yield milk in abundance. We milked them and drunk, while such was the state of the other people that they did not have a drop of milk, nor could they find anything in the animals' udders. And our people began to say, إِسْرَوْ حَيْثُ تَصْرَعُ غَنَمُ بِنْتِ أَبِي زُعَيْبٍ فَتَرُوهُ أَغْنَامُهُمْ جِيَاعًا مَا تَبِدُّ بِقَطْرَةِ لَبَنٍ وَتَرُوهُ أَغْنَامِ شُبَّاعًا لُبَّانًا. She says, our people began to say to their shepherds, go and graze in the very same place the daughter of Abu Zu'aib's shepherd goes. She says they graze in the very same place. But even then, their flocks came back hungry, not yielding a drop of milk, while mine had milk in abundance. She says, when we took Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to our house, every house in the village began to smell of musk. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was love, was put into the hearts of everyone. And so blessed Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, so blessed he was, that whenever anybody was sick or in pain, we would take this child's palm and we would place it on the area which was in pain, and that person there and then would become better and he would no longer be in pain. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed with her for a period of time, and she took good care of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith which can be found in Tabaqat of Ibn Sa'd and Dalail of Abu Na'im, narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, it is mentioned, كانت حليمة لا تدعه يذهب مكانا بعيدا فغفلت عن. That as the Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha would take good care of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she kept an eye on Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all the time and did not let Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go far. Once at midday, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went with his sister to the lambs. Noticing Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam missing, Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha immediately went to look for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Finding Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his sister in the scorching heat, Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha said to her, in this heat you have taken Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam out? She replied, oh my mother, the heat has had no effect on him. As I saw a cloud giving Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shade wherever Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith thereafter states, وَكَانَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُشِبُّ لَا يُشْبِهُ الْغُلْمَانِ. That Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was growing up like none of the other children grew. She says, فَلَمَّا فَصَلْتُهُ قَدِمْنَا بِهِ عَلَىٰ أُمِّهِ وَنَحْنُ أَحْرَثُ شَيْءٍ عَلَىٰ مَكْسِهِ فِينَا. That when I finished weaning him, as was the custom, we brought Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his mother. Though at the time we were very anxious on keeping Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with us for a longer period because of the blessings that we had seen, because of the blessings that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought us. She says, I spoke to his mother and I said to her, leave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with us till Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes a big boy, as I am afraid on his account of the pests of Makkah. She says we persisted till she sent Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam back with us. فَوَاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَبَعْدَ مَقْدَمِنَا بِشَهَرَيْنَ أَوْ ثَلَاثَةٍ مَا أَخِيهِ مِنَ الرَّدَاعَةِ لَفِي بُهْمٍ لَنَا خَلْفَ بُيُوتِنَا جَاءَ أَخُوهُ يَشْتَدُّ فَقَالَ ذَاكَ أَخِي الْكُرْشِي قَدْ جَاءَهُ رَجُلَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا ثِيَابٌ بِيضٌ فَأَجَاءَهُ وَشَقَّ بَطْنَهُ. She says some months after our return, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his foster brother were with our lambs behind our tents, when all of a sudden his brother came running and said to us, two men clothed in white have seized that Quraishi brother of mine and thrown him down and opened his belly and are stirring it up. Now in the narration of Muhammad ibn Zakariya al-Ghilabi, from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, there is quite a bit of detail as how this event of splitting of the chest and the cleansing of the heart took place. However, I would like to mention that Muhammad ibn Zakariya is da'if, is a weak narrator, as is of the opinion of Dar al-Qutni, who says, yasna al-hadith. However, on the other side, we have Ibn Hibban, also a master of hadith, who has mentioned Muhammad ibn Zakariya al-Ghilabi being from amongst those narrators that are thicker, that are sound, and he has said that his hadith is accepted if he narrates from a thicker, a sound narrator. The great Imam Baihaqi himself was in doubt in whether he should relate his hadith in his book, Dalail al-Nabuwa, but after having made istikhara, Imam Baihaqi rahimahullah chose to relate his hadith. Now, because there seems to be a difference of opinion amongst the ulama regarding the hadith of Muhammad ibn Zakariya al-Ghilabi from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, I personally will only relate that portion of his hadith which is supported by other authentic hadiths. It is related in his hadith that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha, Ke ya umma, ma li la ara ikhwati bin naha. O mother, why is it that I don't see my brothers during the day? Hazrat Halima Sa'adiyya radiallahu ta'ala anha replied, Yar'auna ghanaman lana, fayuruhuna min laylin ila laylin. That they take the lambs for grazing, and they will return in the evening. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only a child, began to cry and said to his mother, Ya Ummah, فَمَا أَصْنَوْ هَاوْنَا وَحْدِي إِبْعَثِينِ مَعَهُ. What am I going to do all alone here by myself? Let me go with my brothers. From then on, Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha began to send Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with her brothers. The hadith states, فَكَانَ يَخْرُجُ مَسْرُورًا وَيَرْجِعُ مَسْرُورًا. That Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go happily and he would return very happily. Like this one day, فَلَمَّا كَانَ يَوْمًا مِّن ذَلِكَ خَرَجُوا يَرْعَوْنَ بُهْمًا لَنَا حَوْلَ بَيُوتِنَا. One day, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was grazing. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had gone with his brothers to graze the lambs. When all of a sudden, midday, Damura, Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha's son, Abdullah, came crying, running to his mother, saying, Oh mother, quickly, quickly, go and say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha asked the child, what has happened? He replied, Baina nahnu qiyamin, baina nahnu natarama wa nal'ab, izatahu rajulun fakhtatafahu min awsatina. That whilst we were playing amongst ourselves, a man came and he took him from amongst us to the mountains. And whilst we were playing, split open his chest. And I do not know what they have done with him. She says, my husband and I ran and made our way towards Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We found Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the mountain, shakhisan bi basarihi ila samaa, looking towards the heaven. In some of the narrations, it is mentioned that they found Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the color of his face had changed. They took hold of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha began to comfort Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then she asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what's the matter? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam related the whole incident of what had happened to him. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whilst I was playing with my brothers, three men came. بيد أحدهم إبريق فدة وفي يد الثاني تسطن. One of them had a silver needle in his hand, while the other had a gold basin full with snow. فانطلقوا بي إلى ذروة الجبل فأضجعوني على الجبل إضجاعا لطيفا ثم شق من صدري إلى عانتي وأنا أنظر إليه فلم أجد لذلك حسا ولا علما. They took me to the mountains. They put me on the floor very gently. And then they began to split my chest to the lower part of my belly while I was watching, and I felt no pain. He took out my intestines and thoroughly washed them with the snow and then returned. The second said to the first, Danaha, move. قَدْ أَنْجَزْتَ مَا أَمَرَكَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. As you have done what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you to do. He moved, the second one came close, took out my heart and split it open. And then he extracted a black clot from it, saying, and threw it away, saying, هَذَا حَزُّ الشَّيْطَانِ مِنْكَ. That this black clot is the clot of Satan in you. Then he filled my heart with belief and wisdom and then put it back in its place. The third told the other two to move, saying that you have done what Allah has ordered you to do. And the third passed his hand over that part of my chest and it was healed. Then one of them said to his fellow, weigh him. زِنُوهُ بِعَشْرَةِ مِنْ أُمَّتِ. Weigh him against 10 of his community. They weighed me against them and I outweighed them. Then he said, weigh him against 100 of his community. They weighed me against 100 of them and yet again I outweighed them. Then they said, weigh him against 1,000 of his ummah. Yet again they weighed me against them and yet again I outweighed them. Then he said, leave him. As if you were to weigh him against all his ummah, even then he will still outweigh them. They embraced me, kissed my head, kissed me between the eyes. And then they said, O beloved, do not fear. If only you knew the blessings that are meant for you, you would be delighted. And then they said, how honored you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah and his angels are with you. In Hazrat Abu Zar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and whose version of the hadith, it is said that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that they left me. That they left me and I can almost see them still. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's foster father heard this story, he said to Hazrat Halima Sa'diyah radiallahu ta'ala anha, O Halima, I'm afraid that this child has had a stroke. Quickly take him back to his mother before the result appears. She says, we took Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his foster mother, Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha, who in turn asked why we had brought Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam back when we were very anxious in keeping Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a longer period. I said to Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha, Allah has let my son live and I have done my duty. I'm afraid that ill will befall him. So I have brought him back to you as you wished. Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha says that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's mother, Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha, asked what had happened. And she gave me no peace till I told her. When she asked if I feared a demon possessed him, I replied that I did. Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha said to me that no demon had any power over her son, who had a great future before him. And then Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha related how that when she was pregnant, a light came out of her, which lighted up the castles of Busra in Syria, and that she had borne him with the least difficulty imaginable. And when she bore him, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his hands on the ground, lifting his head towards the heaven. Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha told Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha to leave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Hazrat Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha left with her husband. This was the first time this event took place. And the reason behind it, as has been mentioned in the hadith, was to take out the clot of shaitan, so that the shaitan has no effect on Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in any way whatsoever. The second time this event took place was when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a child of 10 years old. And the reason behind it was so that the heart becomes pure from the matter of lahw wa la'ib, games and play, as this diverts one's attention to other things besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith regarding this can be found in the Dalail of Abu Nu'aym and Sahih ibn Hibban, narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala. The third time this event took place was at the time of prophethood, so that the heart can bear the revelation, the wahi. And the hadith regarding this can be found also in Dalail of Abu Nu'aym and Musnad Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi, narrated by Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And the fourth time this event took place was at the night of Mi'raj, so that the heart can bear everything of the next world. And the hadiths regarding this can be found in Sahih Muslim, Sahih Bukhari, Tirmizi, Nasai, and many other books. Some narrations also state that this event took place a fifth time when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was 20 years old. However, I'd like to mention that the muhaddiseen, the masters of hadith, said that these narrations are weak and cannot be taken. So my brothers, this is how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's heart, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's chest was split, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's heart was cleansed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me the tawfiq. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give you the tawfiq to learn. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.